We'll be right back. Oh my God, I was muted all this time. Sorry, guys. Hello. Hello, everyone. Welcome. I was muted. So let me start that again. Okay. So today we are going to see the preferences folder. Okay. And discuss about this folder and what exactly, what is the purpose of this folder. And also we are going to see some secrets that it hides, and later we can discuss about how we can save some cheap RAM on our machines and some fast RAM, and then we can discuss about some patches that you might need to install on your machines. Feel free to ask me whatever you want. My name is George Sokianos. I'm Golkero on various forums, and this is one of the streams that I started to do just to discuss with you and help you understand more the AmigaOS operating system. We are going to focus on AmigaOS 3.2 because it is the latest version that was released. And we are going to see today the preference folder that a lot of people are using, but it will be interesting to see some things that a lot are not quite familiar. For example, what is the purpose of a folder like presets and where the preferences are saved. Hope you hear me well. So tell me if you have any question. I'd like to welcome here Aris Amiga, Carbob 14XYZ, Concocts, and Damey 3300. Welcome, guys. Hope you enjoy the stream. So preferences is a folder where a few applications are stored that have the ability to help the user with an easy interface to change the way the operating system is working or looks and feels. Okay, so there are things like pointer, where you can set or design your own pointers for every single status. There are things like input, where you can set the speed of the pointer. If it has acceleration or not, you can make it really slow if you want. Or change the keyboard, key map, or change the key repeat delay and things like that. We are not going to get more into every single of these applications. Welcome, Samurai Crow. Welcome to the stream. I'm not going to explain every application what it does, because it will need a long time to do it. But I would like to discuss with you a few things, like when you open an application, where you press save, where these preferences that you selected are saved. When you press use, what the AmigaOS does. Welcome, Ulysses. Good evening. We are doing a stream today about preferences. So it is part of the section of my streams where we get more familiar with the AmigaOS and the different folders that consist the AmigaOS. And today we're going to discuss about preferences, where the changes that we do are saved, and what exactly we can do with that. Also, we are going to see how we can save some cheap RAM on our systems, what patches we could install, etc., and we can discuss about that all together. So, every preference application has some new items. Hello, Levelord, welcome to the stream. Have some menu items like open, save as, and here in edit you will see reset to defaults, last saved, and restore, and we can see exactly what those means. Every application in preferences, you can save whatever changes that you are doing in a preset. This can be done by save as. For example, if I do some changes here, for example, remove this and do a save as, it asks me to save the file at the presets folder, which is the same folder that we see here in presets. The reason that we might need to do that is that we might want to have different presets of all the configurations for specific reasons. For example, you might want to have a specific preset with low resolution and low number of colors. Instead of doing all the time the same things, you can save it as a preset and then go to the config file and to the preferences application and load it. Let's see that. If I go to the screen mode and I select that I want only 16 colors and lower resolution, I can save that as here in presets. Let's say 16 col low. And I can give it an extension .pre if we want to do that. Aris Amiga, what do you mean by preset? Preset is a specific selection of options that we save in a file. Okay, you might have for the same thing multiple presets. Okay, so we will save it as 16 color low. Okay, and now this is going to be in this folder here. Okay, so if I do right now cancel, nothing changes. Okay, if I open screen mode and go here and open the preset, it gets all the changes that I did. Lower resolution and lower number of colors. This is extremely useful, especially if you want to exchange preferences with other users. And instead of them to need to go and replace all their preferences if they want to test something, this is extremely useful. Let me lower the blinds because the sun decided to blind me. So here we are. Let's continue. Another thing that you might like to know is those three selections. So reset to defaults. Reset to defaults means it resets the configuration but doesn't save anything to the defaults of the program. You see, when I selected that, that's the the high-res PAL is selected and four colors is also selected. This is the default configuration of the screen mode for example, we install the AmigaOS from scratch and we don't do any changes, and especially if we don't use glow icons, because for the glow icons, automatically it changes to the 16 colors. That's the default options that are selected as they were created by the developers. Okay. Now, if I do last saved, if I select last saved, these are the options that I set the last time that I selected, I did all my changes and clicked on the button save. Okay, how we can use that, and if we want to test something, for example, I lower right now the colors and click or use, sorry, it will lower the number of colors of my screen. If I want to revert to what I had before I do that change, come on. I can go into the screen mode and select the last saved. Ulysses says, do glow icons require a certain amount of color? Actually, they don't. You can use as many colors as you want, but it is recommended to use at least 16 colors on your screen so that they can look good. Hello, Amiga Gamer 1200. Welcome to the stream. Ulysses, is that clear? So right now, if we do last saved, it uses that configuration. And the last menu item is restore. Restore, the reason that this menu item is there is when we do any changes here, okay, but we don't save or we don't click any other button, we can click restore just to revert all the changes that we did. 16 colors in Workbench is my preference. Yeah. Right now, Ulysses, we are on an emulated Amiga, and because we have some power, some more power, I use 256. Colors, but yeah, on my classic Amiga 1200, I use also 16 colors. So let's see what happens when we click on save and when we click on use. The Amiga OS has two folders: the environment ENV. And the ENVARC, the ENV archive. So, where are these folders saved? These folders are not inside presets that someone might expect that they were there, but if you go in this folder preferences and you do show all files, you will find a folder named env archive. And this folder has these files in this installation. Okay. The default folder that you always will find there is sys, which has the default icons for the various file types. For example, the default icon for IFF. Let me see. Here, this icon, where this icon has information on what will be the default tool that is going to be used whenever you have this file type and you double click what tool is going to use. Okay, for example, if I go to C and do an information, it's going to show us the text edit. Okay, so if you want to change the default tool about the C files, you can come here and change it. Of course, this is going to be applied on files that do not have their own icon, because if you have a C file that has its own icon and there is another tool set, then if you change it here, this is not going to be applied to the application, the file that has its own icon. So this sys folder has all the default icons and also have all the saved preferences for each application of the preferences. For example, for the screen mode, we have a screen mode preferences file. The env archive has those files. If we go to see the environment, let me open a cell. The environment cannot be seen in the hard disk because it is saved in RAM, and you are not, if I'm not wrong, this is not, this is here. You can see it here in RAM. Okay. So you will see in RAM the env, like the ENVARC, has the same folders, pretty much the same, and files. And for example, sys might have the same exactly files. Here is from the ENVARC and here is from the env. The env is the folder that has the same files like ENVARC, but the storage of this folder is temporary. It is saved on RAM, and whatever change you make on that folder, if you copy a file or you make changes on those files, as soon as you reboot, these changes are going to be lost. Ulysses says, if there is a default icon for LHA, no, not exactly. No, there is not. I'm looking if this, but I think that it is going to use the default archive, this icon. Because if you go to the default icons program and you find the LHA archives, yeah, here. Where is it? Here is the archive, LZX. Ah, yeah, here it is, LHARC. It uses the parent icon, the parent here is the archive, so it uses by default the archive icon. So all these files, file types, use the same icon, and if you set to this icon that it uses a specific application, all these file types are going to use the specific application. Now, if you want to have different icons, You can do that with creating a new icon in dev, or by copying an icon from wherever you find it. So I was saying that the end folder has temporary files that are going to be reset when you reboot your machine. And the ENVARC folder has the files that are saved in your hard disk. So when you are using a configuration, a preferences file application, like the screen mode, if you press use, this saves the preferences, the changes that you did in the environment folder here. Okay. If you press save, this at this time, the preferences, the changes that you did are going to be saved both on environment and the ENVARC. The reason for that is if they are not going to go to the environment, they are not going to be applied on your system. Okay, so but it saves that also to the ENVARC, so that these changes are going to be to survive after a reboot. Is that clear? Do you want some extra information? So if you open a cell, and you do ENVARC here, you see you are in system prefs ENVARC archive. And if you do env, you are inside the RAM. Okay. And let's see the AmigaOS 3.1. Let me read you what exactly they say about those two folders. ENVARC is the name assigned to the directory sysprefs ENVARCHIVE, which is always contains the sys directory, in which each of the preferences editors stores the prefs file created when you save a setting with each save gadget. Okay, custom default icons created in icon edit are also saved here. And for the ENV, it says that it is a directory of RAM ENV, into which the contents of ENVARC are copied while when booting. Preferences settings activated with save or use gadgets are stored in ENV. Global environment variables are also stored here as small files. Global environment variables are a pretty interesting concept, and most of the operating systems have something like that. For example, you will see in RAM ENV, there are a couple of environment variables like the language or the kickstart, which I think they are text files, and we can see their content. For example, kickstart has this number there. And the language has this value. So you can create these variables there, and you can use them in every application that you would like to do it. For example, I know that Amiga Amp, the application that is used to play MP3 song files or listen to online radio stations is saving some of this information in environment variables. For example, the title of the song that is playing, or the status of the application if it is playing a song or not. And this can be read by any application. And also, this can be read and used here in the title bar of Amiga of the Workbench. And this can be done from the Workbench preferences folder, preference application, sorry. And you can do that here. If I want to show there something, a variable from the environment. For example, let's say that I want to show the kickstart. Let's say I want to show the version of kickstart, this value here. I can come at the end, or better, let's go to the start so that we can see it. Let's say here, and add from this the environment variable, and add here the name of the variable. The name of the variable is kickstart. Insert. It inserts this text here. So if I do use, for example, let me close the text edit. Ulysses says that it's clear and really useful. Yeah, it is. It is useful because you can do various things. For example, you can put here on the top, if you want, to see these variables as I'm trying to do that right now. Let me try to come on. For example, if you use AmigaOS, you can have there all the time the title of the song, for example, things like that. But also, you can do other things. For example, if you are using visual preferences, and you are and you want, can you put the time in the menu bar? Yeah, you can do that. You can do that. And actually, there is an application released by Ignacio Gulli. Ignacio Gulli is one of the developers of AmigaOS 3.2, and we had a discussion a few weeks ago. You can find the stream that we did together about AmigaOS 3.2 after the release. Ignacio Gulli did an application, a small application, that does exactly that. Saves the time to the an environment variable, which you can use, like we did here. Let me try. Which you can use and print that value to the title bar. So you can see here that this environment variable changed. If I go with tools and text edit and change that value, kickstart, for example, and save it. With the next refresh, it will update here. And I did that change only to the environment folder so that this can be overridden with the next reboot. Let me see if I can find that application that changes the time in an environment variable. And this way you can set whatever you want in the title bar. Any questions, anyone, for that? Or, I was saying that if you have preferences, like the visual preferences, or if you use other applications like the one for the palette that locks the palette and things like that, you can get all these preferences that you create on your machine and combine them into a folder, and like that create a theme. And if you want to change the theme, the way that your application, that your Workbench is looking, you can copy the files, the preferences files from this folder to the environment, and this is going to be applied. And like that, I think that's the way that the AmiKit is using the different themes that they have created. Let me go to AmiNet. Also, yes, that's it. No, it's not that. Because it is from 2014, and it's this one is for OS 4. Let's search for clock and order that by date so that we can get the latest. Any ideas on how this can be used or applied? Do you have, guys? And have in mind that this is happening really fast, so you don't use any resources from your machine. This is pretty light. From the last week, we discussed the last week stream. We discussed about how we can save some RAM and how we can save some cheap RAM. We are going to see that today as well and discuss about that. And if you have any patches or anything that you are using, please feel free to tell me. I think that's the one, date var. Yeah, Ignacio Gulli. Let me download it. And let's see that. So if we go here and unzip that to RAM, date var to RAM, like that, let's see what it has, what's in the, okay, displays date and time on Workbench title bar. Okay, just pick the version that matches to your OS. From the available drawers contained, okay. And put it in the Workbench startup. Let's do that. And I'm doing that straight without reading a lot of things because I trust Ignacio that did a good job there. You may double click on its icon located in the Workbench startup drawer to execute it, or alternatively, just reboot. Okay. Overview and users. The Workbench preferences editor allows customization. Let's see what it does, if it does anything. Like that. I double click that. Okay. Let me see if it saves anything on, yeah. You see, it has here the date var raw, and date var strip CMDS. So if I open this one, no, sorry, with tools and the text edit. Let me open that. So it has the time and the date of the of my machine. And you and we can add it the way that we did earlier with an environment variable. For example, if I remove that and do date var, you see it is added already at the top of my AmigaOS. So someone will think, okay, if we have all the preferences and everything like the default icons of every file type and things like that into the RAM stored, isn't it going to waste so much memory that might not need it? And that's true. And for that reason, before the AmigaOS 3.2 was released, we were using some patches like the Happy Environment, and what these patches were doing was, and I will show you that exactly right now, the reason of these patches was to just copy into the RAM the environment variables and the files that are needed, or better say that as soon as the system or an application requests for a specific file, then that file is copied from the ENVARC to ENV. Okay, that's why you will see that in I think sys from the ENV side and sys from the ENVARC side, you will see here on the ENV much less files than the ENVARC, than the ones that has that are stored in ENVARC. But have in mind that for AmigaOS 3.2, this feature is already built in the AmigaOS. You don't need to use anymore the Happy Environment or any other similar application, because AmigaOS 3.2 does that from the first installation. So this is a good way to save some memory. And of course, if you have any machine that is low on available memory, it will be better not to have too many default icons for different file types, so that these files are not going to be copied into your environment folder and lose memory because of that. And what else? We can see right now how we can save some chip memory. Let me do a restart, if you don't mind. So, any question, any proposal by you guys? Anything that is not understandable? Everything clear, eh? Okay, great, great. So right now we have 1.4 megabytes of graphics chip RAM. Okay, the chip RAM for AmigaOS is necessary for everything that is designed on the screen. For example, if I go and lower the screen mode and the number of colors, like that. I would expect the chip RAM to have less RAM used over here, right? But come on, we are on 2021 and we want to use iBrowse and other applications, and we want to use many icons. For example, if I open this folder and I open this folder as well, and then open the tools, you see that the amount of chip RAM is reduced, because all this information is all this data are stored in the chip RAM. What we can use for that, let me first restore the screen mode. We usually were using another patch for AmigaOS 3.9. Welcome, and Pagoni 73 and Preseda, welcome to the stream. Today we are looking on the folder preferences and the ENVARC environment folders, and the differences between these two, and what's the purpose of these two folders, the ENV and ENVARCHIVE. And also we are going to see right now how we can save some chip RAM on our systems. So with AmigaOS 3.9 and the older versions, and also with AmigaOS 3.1.4, we were using usually the FBLIT. The FBLIT patch was something that forces the graphics and data that needs to be stored in chip RAM to move to the fast RAM, so that we can have more chip RAM available and also have higher resolutions and higher number of colors and better looking icons. But from the AmigaOS 3.2, and this is not only for AmigaOS 3.2, you can do that on any version. The let me see where it is, FAQ. The developers recommend to not use FBLIT anymore, because it is doing things in a way that are not that is not so clean way to do it on AmigaOS. And instead of that, they propose to use Picasso. And we will see, even if you don't have a Picasso card, they propose to use Picasso for that. Let me see if I can find. No. So you can use Picasso. Let us do that. Instead of the help and the FAQ is over there, we can find it later. So I'm going to download Picasso from the Aminet, and there is also a Picasso driver called Native, created by Thomas Richter, if I'm not wrong. We can see that. Native P96, if you search with that. It is a driver that does pretty simple things. Actually, it disables the usage of Blitter, and it forces the graphics to be written in fast RAM. Okay. And we will see how we can install it. Thomas Richter, you see here, is a developer also for AmigaOS 3.2, and he is the maintainer of Picasso for individual computers right now, because Picasso right now it is developed by individual computers, and you can find it on icomp.de, their website, and you can buy a newer version than the one that is on Aminet. But for now, we are going to use the one from Aminet, which I believe is going to work fine for what we want to do. Preseda says, Walker, which mice are supported regarding scroll wheel? I mean, is there any requirement how they must be connected to Amiga, USB, PS2, or what? It's about the protocol. The protocol, okay. I think the USB ones are working with the free with the wheel support that is coming with the AmigaOS 3.2. For me, I use for a long year, for a lot of years right now, I use the Cocolino adapter, which is a PS2. For me, I still needed to install free wheel. These parts to make the wheel be used on AmigaOS 3.2. It depends of the protocol, I believe, of the mouse and the adapter that is used. So Picasso, let me find it here, Picasso 96, the version 2, okay. Preceda, you have something specific in your mind that you would like to see if it works or not with the wheel support? For example, on emulated Preceda, on emulated Amigas, it works out of the box. You don't need to do any patches to add any patches or anything. It works pretty fine out of the box. And I believe that's the case on if you use Raspberry Pi and maybe. AmiBerry, the emulator, if you use that, I believe that it works fine. I didn't test it, but I believe that it would work without any problems. So I downloaded the Picasso 96, and also I downloaded the native driver. Let's extract the Picasso to RAM. Does anyone else here is using AmigaOS 3.2 with a specific mouse so that he can share if the wheel is working with him or not? Actually, how many of you already have AmigaOS 3.2? Would you like to share your opinion in the chat? Because for me, as I said so many times, it's the best release for AmigaOS 3. But what's your opinion? And Pagonis says the best OS I think so far. And Pagonis, have in mind that there is out there AmigaOS 4 as well. So I don't know if this is the best OS. But of course, it's a matter of preferences. Okay. Preceda says, I'm still waiting for my 3.2, but I use several PC mice with my Amigas via various adapters. So Precetta, you are going to do the best thing to test all these adapters, and I guess you are going to have a good experience of what is working or not. Feel free to share this experience with everyone. I have 3.2, says Amiga Gamer 1200, running on a Raspberry Pi FS UI. You're using FS UI on Raspberry Pi? Is it fast? It's a Raspberry 4. I'm talking about Classic Amiga, says Paganis. Yeah, right. No worries. Amiga Gamer 1200, my scroll wheel works out of the box. Logitech USB wireless. But I haven't tried wheel mouse with real Amiga yet. Ah, okay, yeah. Yeah. Actually, Amiga Gamer, I have also a Logitech here, wireless. And it works fine on the emulator. Yeah. Presetta says, I have ordered my OS at day one, but it's still somewhere in Germany or wherever. I don't get it. Actually, you should be one of the first that should have it. Because you are too close to the base of the development team, I guess. Hyperion is in Belgium, so why? Would you like to share from where did you order it? I use real Amiga 1200 with Vampire 1200. Nice, and Pagonis, nice, very nice. And you have 3.2 installed there. Did you have any issues? Amiga Gamer says it's fine, but you have to recompile from source to get the best experience. Okay, it's not big deal if you know how to do it. Raspberry Pi 4 with 4 GB, and you are using, I guess, a specific distribution, Linux distribution, to run it, right? And Have you tested if that gets any resources and you lose any speed against, for example, installing something more simple with AmiBerry? Because AmiBerry as an emulator is pretty good for the Raspberry and those machines, because it is more targeted and optimized for these CPUs. I don't know if FSUI, the developer of FSUI, did any work on specific to make it work even faster on ARM CPUs. Ulysses says that scroll wheel works beautifully in Mac OS with trackpad gestures. Okay, nice. I never tried that on Mac OS, sorry. And Pagon says, I made baby clean installation and everything is fine. I made a clean installation, okay. No baby clean, okay. Had no problems whatsoever. Great, that's nice, that's nice. And I guess that as soon as you install all the necessary applications that the Vampire needs to run even faster for the optimization, it's going to fly on your machine. That's a very nice machine over there. Just standard. Raspberry OS Debian, yeah, which is built for ARM version 6. I compile FSUI for V8 and Neon. Mm-hmm. Nice. Nice, Amiga Gamer. On GitHub development. Ah, okay. Yeah, FSUI is pretty good. For me, it's one of the best. But I don't know. I feel that it would be better if for a Raspberry Pi we could have something with less Linux installations, more close to the bare metal, if it's possible. The Amibian was a very, it is a very nice approach, although I haven't tested the latest version 1.5, if I'm not wrong, because actually it does something like, it has a full distribution of Linux, and I wouldn't like that. But I understand the people that would like to use something like opening Linux applications inside the AmigaOS environment. Although this is not exactly that, but I understand their opinion on that. And Pagoni says that it is running very fast and stable as hell. Yeah, AmigaOS 3.2 is too, it's really stable. And that's because, in my opinion, because all the needed patches that we had to install after the first installation of OS 3.9 are already included. I also use version 51 of Peter K icon library, and that makes the system even faster and colors are more vibrant. Nice thing. Amiga Gamer, that Commodore 64 emulator, you mean the one that is bare metal? That is crazy. I was reading about the response time and how close it is on the real Commodore 64. It is crazy. BMC 64, yes, that's the one. Yeah, think about having something like that for Amiga. Eh? It will be super fast. I hope someone ports FSUI to bare metal. Yeah, I don't know if it is possible, but that would be crazy fast. Thanks for the chat, guys. I like the feedback, so bring it on. Bring it on. As I said on my previous streams, the reason that I'm doing Twitch streams is for the feedback and for the discussions that we can have here. So feel free to tell me whatever you want. So Picasso 96 install. Before I continue with that, do you have any other way to do something like that? For example, any other patch or application that you are using on your machines to transfer data from cheap RAM to fast RAM? If you do, please write it on the chat so that I can investigate them as well and learn about that. So we are going to install Picasso. Have in mind, let me show you that, where is it? That on my machine, sorry, let me show you one thing. Yeah, on my machine I don't have no graphics card memory, okay, so it doesn't have any RTG graphics cards are not set up, so we don't have any RTG card. Like a bare Amiga 1200 with just 8 MB of fast RAM, that's all. Okay, proceed. First install. Okay. Picasso 96 from individual computers. Yes. And it gets a lot of updates, which is pretty good. I bought it the first version that it was released a couple of years ago, and Jens from the individual computers does the thing that it doesn't charge it a lot, but you have to update your versions. You have updates for your version that you bought for 1 year. After 1 year, you can, if you want to get newer versions, you have to buy it again. So after the year ended, I bought it again and I have it. Although that I don't have any Picasso on my Amiga 1200, but I like it and I want to support the development. Picasso 96 is a complex piece of software and requires some experience to install and configure. If you are a beginner with the Amiga, actually we are going to use the default configuration so we can proceed. Please read the documentation before installing. No. And here we are not, we are going to select Picasso 4, but we are going to remove it later. Or let me select UI and Picasso 4 because we might want to use it later. Library files. Yes, it's libraries, monitors, the preferences. Let's save it there. And Pagoni says, correct, never mind, we need to support them. Yes, everyone who creates software for Amiga needs to be supported. How much does Picasso 96 cost? I do not see pricing on the website. Amiga Gamer, I think it's something around 11 or 12 euros. But you get all the updates for the whole year. Okay. And there are at least every 3 months there is something released. Hello, Dummy 3300. Yuichi Flip says, pay what you want. Think Jens suggests 6 euros. I think Yuichi Flip, this was the first time that they released it a year ago. I think that the price right now is pretty much specific. But I might be wrong. Preseta says, I do not need Picasso 96 if I do not have any graphics card, right? For what we are going to do right now and for emulated Amigas, you don't need it. Because you can use the one that is available on Aminet. Sure. Yuichi Flip, if I'm wrong, feel free to say that here because I might be wrong and he might change it. So Picasso settings file there. Now, where do you want to have the support files installed? I don't have a work Picasso. Let's install them to expansion. Do you want to have the application drivers copied to your hard disk? Yes. Do you want to have the P96 to be automatically? No. Okay. That's fine. Actually, let me see if we can check that right now. The price of Picasso. Let me open a browser. I'm sure you don't see anything. It says 9 euros and still pay what you want. Ah, okay. That's fine. Your license says if I have no graphics card, does P96 still offer anything? I thought it was driver for graphics card. It is driver for graphics card, and have in mind that it's not for all the graphics cards, because not every graphic card for the Amiga is supporting Picasso. If you don't have any graphics card, you probably don't need that. If you have, even on an emulated Amiga, you can use the ones that are on Aminet. But if you want to have if you have a Picasso 96, or let's say that you have an emulated RTG environment, okay, AmigaOS, and you want to have Picasso installed, it is better to have the latest, because on the latest version, I think that they added a way to even have the dragging screen feature. Because by default, the dragging screen for Picasso, and it is not working on the oldest version. You can use on WinUI or Pi Amiga's distribution. Also use on Pi Storm or FPGA Amiga. Yeah, sure. It's a flip, you are totally right. Presenter says it's registering a copy of OS 3.2 with Hyperion website, good for something currently, or it will be useful after some new updates. I believe that if you register the AmigaOS 3.2 on the website, it is going to give you access to the future updates. Right now, everything is available. Actually, there is nothing available for AmigaOS 3.2 users from the Hyperion website, except the, we will see it later if you want, the updated NDK that is freely available for everyone to download it. So you don't need to register it. I would recommend for you to register that now, because you might lose the registration number. So do it now, and you don't need to care where to you will store that registration number. No extra downloads for the updates for AmigaOS 3.2. Although that I know that the developers are working on next updates. Hello, Aten. Welcome to the stream. I'm Golquero, and today we see AmigaOS 3.2 things about patches and how we can save some cheap RAM on our systems, and fast RAM as well. And earlier we discussed about the preferences folder, the purpose of this folder, and the environment and archive folders that are somehow hidden. But we discussed what's the purpose of these folders and how they are used and what you can do with them. Yuichi Flip says, yeah, I don't even think it's mentioned the code is on the cellophane, yeah, of the CD. You can try to unstick it from there and then stick it inside the box, and you will be fine. I did that and it worked just fine. Bowman says nothing yet, but obviously if we have to release a 3.2.1 bug fix, this will be the place to get it. Yes, you're right, Bowman. She knows better. Guys, listen to her. Adjusting tool types, monitor driver, proceed. Right now, I'm installing, for anyone that haven't seen that, I'm installing Picasso 96 on the system. Although that we don't have any Picasso card on our emulator, but we are going to use the native driver that is going to help us save some cheap RAM by moving data from the cheap RAM to fast RAM. Welcome, Nulato. Welcome to the stream. Actually, I'm using that solution on my Classic Amiga 1200, and it works very nice. And also, it gives you the ability for some applications that require RTG graphics to work on your machine, although that you don't have a RTG graphics card. Okay, please install the application drivers from the Picasso 96 home directory or from the driver disk. Proceed. Okay. And now I'm going to extract the native to the RAM. Okay. Let me see that. Native README. Installation, install P96, Picasso 96. You may select the graphics card for installation as well if you like, but any such driver is not needed. After installation of Picasso, just remove the Picasso driver from devices monitors if you do not have a graphics card. Drag the icon included in this distribution into the devices monitors and ensure that it is loaded during the startup sequence. For the startup system setup, this will happen automatically. Yeah. You do not need any other programs or any further configuration. If the Blitter replacement functions do not work, make sure you installed an up-to-date version of Picasso 96. That's what Thomas Richter writes for us. And here it has some more information on how this is working, which if you are interested, you can read it whenever you want. So what I'm going to do is open the system, go to devices, monitors, and also open the storage, monitors, okay, and move those files there and move the native here. And let me give it an icon as well, like that, and let's see if we need to change something, but I don't think so. No, everything's fine. Save. So right now we have 1.145, 1.2, let's say, megabytes of memory. Cheap RAM. Okay, let's reboot and see if that worked or we blew our installation. Hello, SLD Snake. Welcome. Welcome to the stream. Hope you have a good time here. We discussed earlier about preferences folder and other folders that are a little bit hidden inside that. The purpose of the preferences folder and where the preferences are saved. And we saw also the some menu items from the preferences programs and how they are used and the meaning of them. Because to be honest, I was also a little bit confused with those selections. So we had a discussion here and how we can use them. And also we are looking how we can save some memory, fast RAM, and some cheap RAM. Preseta says, I have a question that was not answered yet probably. If I turn on AmigaOS with 3.2 ROMs without a hard disk drive, what will I see? Purple screen with a bowling ball? And Bowman says yes. Uh, SLD Snake says, I forgot the stream, maybe different time zones. Where are you, SLD Snake, if you want to share that? And also remember that if you go to the Twitch page of the stream and you go to the schedule, there is a button that if you press it, you will get a reminder every time that the stream goes live. Presetta says, I regret, Bowman, I regret replacing the traditional rainbow checkmark with that boring checkered ball. For me, the only proper Amiga logo is the rainbow tick. SLD Snake is in Spain. Okay. I'm in Ireland, so we should have the same time zone. No. I think we have the same time zone. Ulysses says that he agrees on the bowling ball boot screen. Such a shame we can't have the Amiga tick anymore. What was the last version of ROM that had the tick? Was 3.1. On the other side, you never, if you have a hard disk on your machine, you never see that screen, right? 3.1 says percent, yeah. I've been using a hard disk so many years, I do not even see the boot screen. Exactly, Amiga Gamer. Held out on 3.1 for as long as I could. You can use AmigaOS 3.2 with 3.1 kickstart, although that you are going to lose some memory because of that. On the other hand, you can create such a screen and put it as a backdrop to your machine on the workbench with a tick, and you are going to be fine. SLD Snake says minus 1 hour. Okay, we have an hour difference. Yeah. I'm trying to share more the stream with from various channels, especially from Discord and other channels there, guys, and also from my Twitter account. If you believe that it will be better to share it in other places, forums or anything, please tell me. I will do it and so that you can be informed about that. And I hope that my streams are useful for you all and you have fun here. Or at least you get something and learn something new. Deliberately rooted my SD card outside the case so I can pop it out and boot disks from the boot screen like I'm 15 again. Good idea, Ulysses. Nice. So let's see if we have to do anything else to make native work. I think we shouldn't, but I'm not sure that we saved any cheap RAM, because when I open any folder, I see the cheap RAM being reduced. So let me check again the documentation. There is that backdrop, picture in your Workbench. Although small and few colors only, it eats some cheap RAM. Yes. You could make a try how many bytes will be saved if you disable the background image wallpaper. Sure, let me do that. If I go to Workbench pattern and remove the page, the image, and remove the image from the windows, use it. Amiga Gamer says, I like the Kickstart screen with left hand holding disk to put into right side of Amiga. How uncomfortable to try this. Yeah. It doesn't seem that it saves a lot. And I think that it, even the fast RAM was increased when I removed it. You can yes, preset that 10 kilobytes, not much. You can set a boot screen to display while Workbench starts up, can't you? Yeah, there is a Rail boot. It's an application that is on AmigaOS that does that. Yeah, you can do that. You could make that the 1.3 or 2 disk insert picture. Exactly, and sometimes you might forget that you have that. And say, oh my god, what happened right now? My hard disk failed. What's going on with my Amiga? You might, of course, understand that the boot screen because it is not animated. Eh? Perhaps disable Amiga Blitter flag does not work with old Picasso 96 driver. I see in iComp patch notes it's a new feature. we can try that. I believe that I have here in Essentials. Let me check that. I have the registered one. No, but I can find it. But let me get the native documentation again. And in case I did something stupid. Yeah, Amiga Gamer, you're probably right because I used the one that I get from my iComp. And not the one from the AmiNet, which is also pretty old. It's from 1999, right? From native readme, no graphics card is needed, but a recent version of P96 has to be installed as well. Okay. It seems pretty logical. Let me find it. Give me a second to find it on my hard disk. And let's install this one. But until I find it, let me put some music. So, found it. Bypass the Amiga Blitter now and use the CPU for blitting, thus allowing bitmaps in fast RAM. This requires setting the following variable. Yeah, actually, Amiga Gamer, we shouldn't do anything else than... The native, if I'm not wrong, the only thing that it does is to set that environment variable, and I don't know if also does something else. So I would prefer to use the native driver. Could take just a minute, yeah? Native sets the variable, yeah. Okay, the latest version is... Let's install it. This is the latest version that is available on individual computers website. Might not support the Amiga Gamer says my point was the older versions of P96 might not support the variables set by native driver. Yeah, you are right. Update the installed version. Got the monitor files installed again. Okay. That's right. Okay. Do you want to have no? Please install the application drivers from Picasso 96. A new settings file has been installed and modified. Please run the Picasso 96 mode prefs program after rebooting.
Okay.
I don't think we need to run that. I'm going to remove the monitors. And let me reboot. Welcome, Bloodlust. Welcome to the stream. And welcome 2020. So let's see if that worked at all. System. Again, some memories lost. No. Let me do an installation of Picasso 96 from the scratch, in case there is something that breaks the way that we want it to work, right? In case anyone missed that, or for those that just joined, we try to install Picasso 96 on an Amiga that doesn't have any Picasso graphics card, but we are going to use the native driver, and that will help us save some cheap RAM, and by moving things and data, icons and images, by moving those from cheap RAM to the fast RAM. Uninstall all uninstalled version. Okay, first let's uninstall the previous version. Okay. Yes. Proceed. I'm trying right now to uninstall the previous version and install it again. So right now in preferences, logically we don't have anything with Picasso. If Picasso 96 and native are installed, check if ENVARC, okay. Disable Amiga Blitter contain yes, and the RTG library is loaded. Okay, you're right, Amiga Gamer. I'm going to install it again, and after the reboot, we can see that again. We can check it. But it's good sometimes for what we have in mind to do. If it fails, we can see here the best way to overcome such problems, right? All together, and see how we can fix it or and proceed so that we can get exactly what we need. I know that this thing works because I use it on my classic Amiga 1200. So we can make it work. Okay, please install the application drivers. Thank you very much. Okay. Welcome, Roscoe 500. Hi all. Is there a version of Picasso 96 out there that supports 68,000? The CPU version I tried from Aminet wanted 020. Let me check if there is something on the latest version mentioned here. Or maybe the documentation, this guide has more information. Hardware requirements. Mandatory to use it, Motorola 68020. You have a HC533 turbo card which has 33 megahertz, 68,000. Yeah, I'm afraid that the 68,000 is not supported by Picasso, and it has here the reason is not supported because it does not offer enough computing power to use a graphics card. Larger displays need more computation. It will get unbearable slow. Therefore, parts of the code have been specially written for the MC68020. Yeah, and that's the latest version that is available from individual computers. What I wanted to do is move this Picasso to storage and monitors. Let me delete the older one, this one. I will keep the UI graphics because we might need it if we want to enable an RTG Picasso graphics card on this emulated Amiga. Let me reboot and we will see if this works. Roscoe 500 says, fair enough, I wanted to try the native driver to save cheap RAM. You have this HC533, right? How much memory do you have on your machine? I guess it is a 500, right? So let's see what Amiga Gamer proposed to check the environment variable. And we have here the Picasso 96 folder. Roscoe says 8 megabyte fast, 1 megabyte chip. Yeah, I will say that for you, low number of colors and small resolution will be a good candidate to reduce the memory of the chip RAM, the used memory chip RAM. Okay, let me open the text edit and disable Amiga Blitter. It has yes. But I think that already we gained some memory because right now I have all these things opened and we are 1.69, you see? I think that it works. Not everything is removed from the chip RAM, but we lost less cheaper here. Roscoe says that he's used to four colors and standard high-res mode. Exactly. So I think that the native driver, it works just fine on our machine. But of course, if you want to have higher resolutions and a lot more colors and RTG graphics card is the only solution. Right now what we can do here is to reduce the number of colors to 16 and see how much chip memory we will gain. Would be nice to use overscan without hitting chip RAM and leave out some more game icons, etc. on Workbench. Yeah, possible, but I don't know how doable this is, to be honest. So right now we have a high-res resolution and we have 1.9 megabyte of the 2 megabyte of the machine. So I guess that it's pretty fine, right? With 16 colors and high-res resolution. What do you say, guys? I believe that was successful. I agree, and Pagonis looks perfect. And of course, if you have a RTG card or you can add an emulated RTG card on your emulator, emulated machine, you are going to have resolutions like 1080p and you are not going to have any issues. Amiga Gamer says 1.9 is good. I have 1.6 without Picasso. And do you have any patch installed? Or you mean by bare AmigaOS installation? Roscoe says, didn't get far, the Picasso 96 installer just told me off and quit. Why? Ulysses says, impressive. Yeah, it is. This is really interesting, says Perseda. It's a good way to do that, although, and I didn't know about it. The way that I learned about it, it was the first time that I read the frequently asked questions that the AmigaOS 3.2 developers created, and there is information about that, and for so many other patches that you might want to install. Let me find that section. This is something like high memsys. Nice percent. But I don't know if you tell it anywhere else than my stream or any other stream, that are people who live to see high memsys. I don't know if anyone will understand it. Just 3.2 and a few windows open, says Amiga Gamer. Okay, so you get 1.6 megabytes. Right now, I have the help open here, Amiga Guide, 1.897. So I think it is pretty good, right? You will never have all the memory available, but even 1.9 without, because some games, if you start them from the workbench and they need a lot of memory, with anything lower than 1.8 megabyte of chip RAM, they might not start. If you manage to have 1.9 megabytes, You are king. Presetza says 6400 kilobytes out to be enough for everyone. Ought to be enough for everyone. Yeah, maybe. Famous last words. What other patches do you use? For example, on my Amiga 1200, I use the card reset and card patch for the PCMCIA cards, so that whenever I boot my machine from cold boot, the PCMCIA is initialized just fine and can be used. But what kind of patches you were using or you use right now on your AmigaOS 3.2? Amiga Gamer says yes, 1.9 is good. How now I have to figure out how to buy this off iComp site. It's very confusing. I think that you have to create your account first. Log in with your account and then go to the shop and add it to the basket and buy it. And as soon as you buy it, I think you get access to that pretty much instantly. And have also in mind that you will have only 10 downloads for each version. Okay. If you have a version right now that you are going to buy, you have 10 downloads. But if a newer version is released, you get 10 new downloads. And Pagoni says card reset and card patch as well, and stack attack too. Okay. I think stack attack you don't need to use it anymore. Let me try to find that section. I think it's performance compatibility. Is it here? Yes. What about all those widely used system patches? Can I use them? At the time of this writing, we are proud to tell you that many of those hacks are no longer necessary. Preseta says, yes, talking about PCMCIA, I was surprised its support is not a part of OS 3.2. What do you mean its support? Because of this hardware bug that is... I don't think that it should be part of the OS 3.2, to be honest. But we can ask the developers and they might want to add it, to be honest. Amiga Gamer 1200 says only patch I use right now with 3.2 is I customize the ARIC script at Workbench menu tools, much less RAM than adding 3. Yes. And Amiga Gamer, you remember the previous stream where we did so many changes there. Although I would recommend you to do that on your own menu tools file, because if at some point an update will be released and they change something there, you're going to lose your changes. So it will be better to have your own menu tools file in your Workbench startup. You don't lose anything from performance or anything else. And if you want to make it run before the menu tools, you just change the priorities, the start priorities in the Workbench startup icons. If you remember, we discussed that the previous time, if you go to the information of any of these applications in the Workbench startup, there is a parameter where you set the start priority. Stack attack 2 is included, yes, in the AmigaOS 3.2. It is included. And those are the patches that you don't need anymore to do that. And we discussed earlier about the usage of HappyEnv and Env handler, and we saw that that is already working for AmigaOS 3.2 out of the box. And here, this section 4.6, it's the one that describes the usage of the native driver and Picasso 96. And Pagoni says, can I remove it? The stack attack too, if you have AmigaOS 3.2, you don't need it. But if you see that for some reason it is useful for you, I would say first contact the developers why it is not working with specific applications, and then if you want to use it, use it. If it solves you a problem and it doesn't make your AmigaOS less stable, use it. I think Ulysses says, I think things like that and LHA, etc., should be part of any future release. They are real barriers to getting set up. Yeah, but there are things like the permission to use or include these packages into the AmigaOS, right? Because are created from third party, from third developers. What I'm doing actually is I have a folder or a CD-ROM or whatever you want, where I put all this software that is needed for me, for my computer. And when I do a clean installation, whenever I do a clean installation, I copy that folder and everything on my clean installation, and I have that already there. Yeah, Presenta is legal issues, yeah. On real hardware. And Ulysses, remember that you can download the XAD library from the Haminet and use it as well to de-archive the archives that you use, LHA or whatever. And you can also get the ENVARC from AmigaOS 3.9 and use it on OS 3.2 as well. Ulysses says, on real hardware, of course, especially without a CD-ROM drive. Yes, on real hardware. Amiga Gamer, you missed the beginning of last week. You can find the video from last week on Aminet, on YouTube, and you can also see that on Twitch. It keeps the latest for 15 days latest videos. Welcome DJ Nest and the two Raiders. Welcome to the stream. And Pagonis, okay, I will try it. Great. DJ Nest, raid! Welcome, DJ Nest. Welcome, Vasily. How are you doing? Today we are looking on AmigaOS 3.2 again. And this is something that we are going to keep on doing for a long time. And we saw how we can save some cheap RAM and fast RAM. And also we discussed about patches and about the preference folder and the environment and env archive folder, what's the purpose of them, and everything was discussed here on the stream. Hello, Brother Bill. Amiga, yeah. Let me put some music here while we discuss, and while we are going to the end of the stream. For the next streams, what would you like to see? because we saw patches, we saw applications on the previous streams, we saw a lot of things, but what would you like to see on AmigaOS 3.2 and or what we should install? Any recommendations? I was thinking for the next stream to see how we can install the NDK and how we can install a compiler, although this might be more targeted for developers. I don't know if this is something that you will be interested in, but please tell me if you would like to see something like that. And also, I was thinking, of course, and we will see more folders, investigate more folders from the AmigaOS installation, and we will get more familiar with them. Maybe the tools folder and the purpose of it, and what's the difference between tools and utilities, and why we have tools and why we have utilities. Those two folders will be interesting to investigate and learn more. And we have, while we do the journey of getting more familiar with AmigaOS. But would the information about developers be something interesting for you? I know that Bowman, I don't know if she's here yet, but I know that she knows about things like that and she might not be interested. Dummy 3300, my tip for some next topic. I'll be interested on know something about load module. I don't know how it works. Ah, okay. That will be interesting to discuss. Amiga Gamer says, I have an idea for future streams. Show manual install of WHD load and soft kick. Manual install, okay. Importing alternative Kickstart ROMs to Dev's Kickstart. Dev Kickstart. Install and set up a launcher. I think maybe you know I game quite well. When you say import alternative Kickstart ROMs, you mean Kickstart ROMs that could work with a WHD load, or Kickstart ROMs that would be used by an expansion card, an accelerator to be loaded into the memory? What exactly? Bowman, I bet you do. Maybe you get bored when we discuss about NDK and things like that. Aris Amica, you also know about development, right? Nice, nice. Also, Presetta says, also show us the boot options from early startup menu in detail. Yeah, why not? Like to forensically understand the startup sequence. Ulysses says that. Okay, so for the next time, let's focus on startup sequence with the boot options of the early startup menu, and also the folders that I mentioned earlier, and we will see. After that, if we have time, we can see how we can install VBCC and the NDK. Amiga Gamer says, some WHD load games require a specific Kickstart, which is launched by soft kick through WHD load. Okay. Do you have any specific game that needs something like that? Because what I'm doing actually, whenever I install WHD load, I get those kickstarts and I copy them to the devs folder, and then every game it works just fine. Bowman, yeah, understanding startup secrets could be interesting topic. It is, and actually it is. Thank you, Bowman. Actually, it is interesting because sometimes you need to change something, and it is necessary to know what and where it is better to do it, so to prevent future issues on your machine. And also, it is necessary to know whenever you have issues on your machine in the startup sequence, how to solve them, and not just format your machine and start everything from scratch. Okay, next time we are going to discuss about startup sequence and all this stuff. And then, one of the future streams, we are going to make it all about WHD load and gaming. Although that I'm not sure if I'm going to play, because there are so many streams out there for people who are playing games, and you know that pretty well. Everyone knows that. So we are going to see how we can install WSD load and how we can install the kickstart files, and where we can find these kickstart files, and also how we can install iGame, my preferred WSD load application for starting all these games and organize them. And yeah, we can proceed from that. DJ Nest, you were always a heavy modifier on your startup sequence. That's cool. Yeah, because you needed to do that. Now with AmigaOS 3.2, you don't need to do that. At least, you need to do that in less times than we used to do it. Because if you install AmigaOS 3.9, for example, you will have to spend 2 hours to install all the patches. Now with AmigaOS 3.2, you don't need to do that, right? So you reduce a lot the risk of something to break and go totally wrong. And also used to assign a lot of games and apps in user startup back in the days. Yes, this is necessary. Although that now you don't have to do it because you have assigned words. So whenever an assign is needed, you can assign it at the whenever an assign is needed, you can assign it on a request. Maybe a Vincent demonstration. What are the differences between the integrated cell and Vincent? Ooh, dummy, this is pretty hard for me to do, because I'm not sure that I know a lot on that, but I can search and find that information and present it on one of the next streams, because it is pretty interesting. There are a lot of things in Amiga Cell that we don't know and we don't use, but I don't know how many of you are going to use them. Amiga, especially when 3.2 has several startup sequences. Dumb question, what does startup sequence mean? Let me see if I can find something on AmigaOS DOS. But I believe it's something like that. It's a sequence of commands that is executed on startup, something like that. Here it says each time your Amiga is booted, it executes the startup sequence script file, startup sequence script file located in the S directory. The startup sequence file allocates disk buffers, makes device assignments, reads saved preferences settings, and performs other functions that configure the Amiga for use. So good to have automated apps today to do the job we did manually. You mean about that? You mean what DJ Nest? Amiga Gamer says, although we have a Metal Gear fan here, so start SS might be Solid Snake. Yeah, maybe. Aris Amiga says, always need to double check. Okay. Bowman says, but people don't modify your startup sequence. It is really supposed to be an OS internal thing. Yeah, Bowman, but user startup is for you to play with. Yeah, you are right about that. If you can avoid to edit the startup sequence, you better do. But sometimes it is necessary to run something between commands in the startup sequence. For example, the visual prefs, if I'm not wrong, it needs to be loaded after the iprefs. At least that's what the manual recommends. So this is unavoidable. Presetta says, and opposite is startup sequence. Set patch, DJ Ness says, set patch quiet. Yeah. Bowman says, still good to know what it does, the startup sequence. Yeah. You have to be familiar with that things because in case something goes wrong, you have to be able to fix it. Brother Bill says, but yes, the SS and US are important topics to learn when learning about AmigaOS. Everything is important for AmigaOS to be familiar with and learn more things about it. Because this way you getting better on that and you can find different ways to use this your machine in a better way. DJ Nest says, I love tinkering with startup sequence sometimes. Always keep a backup of startup sequence, of course, in another partition. And when Guru hits the door, just boot with no startup and copy your good one. Exactly. Backup is the most necessary thing to do whenever you do any changes. And especially if you go and install old software, applications that were developed or released in the 90s, it is good to have a look on what they are doing. Even if you don't know how to program things like that, if you open the installer, you probably understand what they are copying where. Especially if they don't use an installer which can compare the versions of libraries and things like that, and they use a plain script. Presetta says, Bowman, as dummy 3300, it says it works, so we are trying to break it. Yeah, maybe. If you don't break it, you will not learn how it works, right? Dummy says, I don't have the AmigaOS 3.2 yet, but in 3.1.4, I struggled with multiview. In some documents, I was not able to wrap text on my basic Amiga setup without RTG. I'll be interested to know how wrapping text works in MultiView 3.2. Okay, let me open something here. Let me open the startup sequence, since we are talking about that. The failsafe startup sequence. It doesn't seem to have any wrapping for texts, but let me check if there is a tooltip for that. No, I don't see anything. Bowman says, yes, there are things that needs to go in there. For example, as a developer, there are some diagnostics that needs to go there. The visual preferences you mentioned and Vabire, I believe, needs to be there too. But it's not for general tinkering. Yeah, Bowman, you're right. It's not for general tinkering. The startup sequence. DJ Ness says, I always keep my Picasso 96 config too. I use specific resolutions on RTG and for the grabber. Okay. Preceda, but basically you cannot harm any Amiga system by altering startup sequence. With any other system, there is a high risk you will have to reinstall everything. With Windows, Preceda, you might break it just by using it. It happened for me so many times. Ars Amiga, I love how it says don't touch this file. at least Ars Amiga, you are warned. DJ Nest, yes, but man, Vampire also has settings on the startup sequence, like the vcontrol and map-rom functions. Yeah, Preceda, it's a magnet. Yeah, if you see something like don't touch it, you are going to touch it. DJ Ness says to load your OS 3.2. This is the MapROM, that's what MapROM does on Vampire, right? To load the kickstart ROM in memory. If you edit, Amiga Gamer says, if you edit startup sequence fail safe, you will be burned at the stake by a rapid horde and teenage Atari fan. Well, thank you everyone. Thank you for being here in this stream. Thank you for making that interesting and joyful. Slowly we are going to close. We will meet again next week if everything goes fine, and we are going to see more interesting stuff. Thank you again for everyone for being here. I hope you enjoyed it. Let me see if anyone else is streaming something so that we can rate them and continue fun with another streamer. Thank you guys, thank you for your kind words and for being here, because as I told you, if we don't have that feedback and exchange of opinions, that stream might not even be so interesting. I don't like to create videos just, you know, videos to install, to upload to YouTube for others to see. I want that communication, and thank you for being here, and you help me on doing what we do. Okay, let's raid. Hazemaker is playing with Commodore 64, I believe. How about raid him? Stream highlights when? You mean when I'm going to upload it? On YouTube, maybe today? Thank you all. Thank you very much for being here. Have a good evening. Let's rate Hazemaker, if I'm doing that right here, because I'm still not familiar with that. And have a good evening. Thank you very much. Bye-bye to everyone. Have a good day. Bye-bye.